Good morning. Welcome to worship on this first Sunday of Lent. It's good to have you here with us in person, with many chairs. Opportunity to spread out as you feel needed. Welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us online live and those who are catching us later as well. It's good to have you with us. If you need the bulletin, you can go to the church website, www.messiahnh.org, and get it there. It is good to have you with us. I would encourage you during Lent, really any time there's water in the baptismal font, especially during Lent, is you come by the font if you want to get some water and mark yourself with the cross in remembrance of your baptism. You are always welcome to do that. That is not just for baptisms. So we'll continue with our remembrance of baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters. And by your word, you created the world, calling forth life in which you took the life. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery and freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons. Help us by making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
And our opening hymn is On Insert on Improvements. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray to the Lord. Kyrie eleison. You led your people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land. Guide us now so that following your Son, we may walk safely through the wilderness of this world for the life you alone can give through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. A reading from Deuteronomy, the 26th chapter. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God has given you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God has given you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, You shall make this response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number. And there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. The word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading Psalm 91 responsibly. You who dwell in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty,
you will say to the Lord, my refuge and my stronghold, my God in whom I put my trust.
Because you have made the Lord your refuge and the Most High your habitation,
no evil will befall you, nor shall affliction come near your dwelling.
For God will give the angels charge over you to guard you in all your ways.
Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone.
You will tread upon the lion cub and viper. You will trample down the lion and the serpent.
I will deliver those who cling to me. I will hold them because they know my name.
They will call me and I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them.
With long life will I satisfy them and show them my salvation.
A reading from Romans, the 10th chapter. The word of God is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, and so is justified. And one confesses with the mouth, and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. You're invited to rise for our gospel acclamation.
Steadfast love, come to us, O Lord. Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord. Save us as you promised, we will trust your word. Steadfast love, come to us, O Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 4th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread. Jesus answered him, it is written, one does not live by bread alone, Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, to you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered him, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Please join me in a word of prayer. May the words of my mouth, may the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. There's an understanding that times in the wilderness, times of retreat, times of being set apart, of focused prayer and meditation can shape people and the way they are in the world. These times can provide testing and tempering and refining and training and maturing and preparing. And I think that's what's up with Jesus in this gospel text. He's out there and he's being made prepared for the work he has to do and the person he has to be in the world. It's just after his baptism and he's driven right out into the desert by the Spirit to be there for 40 days. When I think about this scene, it kind of reminds me of Job and his trials as well. In Job, you have God and you have Satan, the accuser. And they're sitting on the back porch having a glass of lemonade together or something. I have no idea why they're together. But they're talking and God's bragging on Job and what a faithful servant he is. And Satan says, well, yeah, because nothing bad ever happens to him. He's got a big family. He's got lots of crops. He's got all this land. Of course, if you let me take care of him for a while, I bet I could get him to curse your name. Okay, go ahead, says God. Never like this. I think it's a literary device, but I'm just saying it's not the greatest scene for me in the Bible. But so as time goes on, Job loses his wife, his seven sons, his three daughters, his thousands upon thousands of heads of livestock, his property. He's left with nothing. But he doesn't curse God. And so, well, look at my guy. He's still not cursing me. Well, yeah, that's because I joined him to him. Well, okay, you can get him too. Just don't kill him. Okay. And so Satan goes after him and gives him this horrific sores. And the book of Job begins with Job sitting there in ashes, scraping these sores off him with a piece of pot shirt, feeling sorry for himself for 7 days. And then his friends come, and then the whole rest of the book unwinds. Job's trials got so bad that he cursed the day he was born. He never cursed God, but he cursed the day he was born. In Luke, you have the Spirit, which is part of the Trinity. It's God again. Working with the devil, it seems. The Spirit drives Jesus out into the... What is this? These stories where the devil and God are working together? I just don't understand these. But Jesus is sent out into the wilderness for 40 days to be tempted. Both Job and Jesus are righteous, upright, lovers of God. I mean, Jesus was God, for goodness sake. But they face these temptations, these trials, faithfully. 7 days for Job of those sores before his friends, and he start talking. 40 days for Jesus out in the wilderness. Those are big biblical numbers of completion, right? Seven is the 7 days of creation plus seven. 6 days of creation, and then God rested. And so because God rested, we should rest too. And we should have this rhythm where we spend time with family and our family of faith and with Scripture and tend to ourselves and tend to our God. 40 is also a number of completion. You got 40 years in Saul's reign, David's reign, Solomon's reign, 40 years out in the wilderness, 40 days of the flood, 40 days for Jesus out in the wilderness, and for us now, 40 days of Lent. And all of these have this sense that once you're done with the number, the seven or the 40, there comes this big infusion of grace. this new revelation of God, this insertion of goodness after the struggle. There are lots of parallels and symmetries that I see between Job and Jesus. Take a look at them if you want some more. But one of the things that can sustain us during those times of testing and tempering and refining and training and maturing is preparing, is knowing that it's going to come to an end. You know how that is? I can put up with just about anything if I know what the end date is. We can find extra courage, extra reserves, extra tolerance, extra caffeine, whatever it is, to push through that window if we know when it's going to be done, as long as we know when it's going to end. Grad school. When I was at the seminary, I worked like from 10 to 3 in the morning for insurance. I didn't care because it was for a short time. It was doing something worthwhile. When you go through Hell Week, when you go through sleepless nights with the new child, you know it's going to end sometime. So you go through it. It's okay. Basic training, initiations, cleanses, fasts, diets, whatever these things are, we can deal with them because we know they're coming to an end. And we know something good's going to come at the end of it. It's worth doing. I wonder if Jesus knew 40 days. What do you think? I have no idea if he knew that he's only out there for 40 days. But what can be soul-crushing and what can be really life-draining is long-term chronic afflictions where there's no immediate end in sight. That's what gets us. Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS, or Parkinson's, or in my dad's case, multiple systems atrophy, which is like Parkinson's on steroids, which eventually took his life. It's miserable. It just sucks everything from you, not knowing when that's going to end, only seeing it getting worse. Addictions, or in my brother's case, alcoholism, which took his life. That same kind of a thing. Now, there are times when those get turned around. Let's not be all negative, but you know what I'm talking about. When these diagnoses are weighing on us, we can't see them getting any better. Where we can't get affordable or reliable medical care or accessible care to be brought to bear in time, sometimes because it's not around, sometimes because only certain people get it. You know, part of the drain of COVID has been these issues. We don't know quite when it's going to be done. It keeps hanging on and on and on. The masks are off, the masks are back on. We think it's gone, then Omicron shows up. Hey, it's July 4th, have a party. No, sorry, we're wrong, it's back again. That's what makes it so hard. This pandemic has been deadly, obviously, for the so many people who died, and soul-crushing and life-draining for those of us who are still here. In scripture, maybe this looks like the hemorrhaging woman. You remember that story? She's a woman who's been bleeding for 12 years, and she has spent everything she had. And she's gone to every doctor. She's gotten all the best care. She went to Dartmouth-Hitchcock, and she went to Mayo Clinic and wherever else it was back in the day. And she's done everything she can, and she's still bleeding, and she can't get past it. And Jairus' daughter's story gets interrupted by her, because they come to Jesus and say, hey, Jairus, our leader, he's done great things for us. His daughter's really sick. Won't you come take care of her? And Jesus says, sure. And he starts to go there, and then he has to stop to be with the hemorrhaging woman. And then by the time he gets to Jairus' daughter, she's passed away, 12 years old, and she's gone. You know, 12 is a completion number two. You got 12 months in the year. You got 12 apostles. You got 12 tribes of Israel, which probably sponsored the 12 apostles. You got 12 signs of the zodiac. In fact, we were in a synagogue in the Holy Land, and dead in the middle of the synagogue was a zodiac mosaic. That's kind of interesting. You wouldn't have expected that. That's beautiful. I'll say that. But this girl was 12 years old when she passed. That number of completion ended badly. And this woman had been bleeding for 12 years, and she couldn't get better. Same thing. And so here comes Jesus, bringing that good news, bringing that grace, raising Jairus' daughter and curing that woman of her bleeding. Without his intervention, that soul-crushing, life-draining would have continued for them and their families. That's what Jesus does, isn't it? He comes in and he interrupts those cycles. So there are these systems that are still around to this day, systems and chronic afflictions that weigh on people that they can't see the end of. They don't know when it's going to stop, so they can't get out from under its thumb. Things like poverty, things like unjust wealth distribution, things like unfair access to medical care, things like homophobia and racism and transphobia and wars and invasions where you're just doing your thing and next thing you know, this big neighbor is all inside your business and not going anywhere anytime soon and you don't know when it's going to stop. Things like deeply rooted hatred that we can't even remember why we started hating them, but it's still there. We're not going to let go of it. Or inertial political divisions. Well, clearly, if they're for it, it can't be good, even though I don't know why, so I'll vote against it. Or hard-hearted neighbors. They can leave us like Job, cursing the day we were born. Look at these systems that can't be changed. Look at this, it's weighing down on us. We, as people of faith, have a high and holy calling. It's to live out Matthew 25, which is whenever we encounter the least of these, people who are afflicted or cut off or on the fringes, written off by society, we are supposed to go and be there with them, to visit them in prison, to bring them food and water, to pray for them, to clothe them, to welcome them back into society. And Jesus says that when we do these kind of things, we're not just doing it for them, which is sufficient reason enough, but we're doing it unto Jesus himself. The lonely, the cut off, the despairing, the grieving, and people who are in all other manners in spots like Job was, like Jesus was, we're called to go and reach into those. I believe that's why Jesus spent time out in the wilderness, to be equipped to do that ministry. And I believe that we, as people of faith, people who follow Jesus, are called to do that same kind of work. I hope and pray that our Lent will be a time of that renewing and empowering and equipping and inspiring. Let us pray. God, we thank you that you love us undeservedly. We thank you that when we go through hard times, and we all do, that when they come to completion, your grace breaks in ways we never anticipate. Help us be agents of that grace in your world, all to your glory. Amen. We continue with, I want Jesus to walk with me, which is printed in the bulletin. Church, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for the prayers.
Please join with me in the prayers of intercession. Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. We pray for the church. Sharpen its proclamation of the word so that your people learn to reject voices of deception and distraction. Strengthen all who are tempted to believe lies about themselves or others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the earth and all its creatures. Protect wilderness places and all plant and animal species that call them home. Sustain farmers and all laborers who work the land and harvest the fruits of its abundance. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the nations of the world. Awaken elected leaders and government officials to the needs of those who are oppressed, and grant them compassion to deal mercifully with immigrants and refugees who reside among us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those in need. Rescue those experiencing mental illness or contending with addiction. Ease the anxiety of those who live with dementia. Command your angels concerning all who are sick. Especially we pray for Marge, Rita, Albert, Stacy, Claudette, Debbie, Steve, George, Holly, Elsie, John, Pastor Carrie Ballinger, Amparo, the ELCA congregations of the New Hampshire Conference, our partners in ministry, Habitat for Humanity, Ash Street Shelter, SHARE, ELCA World Hunger, Lutheran Disaster Response, Sleep in Heavenly Peace, Family Promises of Southern New Hampshire. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this assembly. Bless those who bake bread and prepare the table for our communion celebration. Accompany those who share the bounty of this meal with those who are homebound or hospitalized. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Here, other intercessions may be offered aloud or in our hearts. We pray today for the people of Ukraine. Stop the bombings, the shootings, the destruction of people and places. Bring peace, Lord God. We also pray for those trying to remain safe in Ukraine, for those trying to leave Ukraine, and for those people who have fled to other countries. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for those who have died. Gather them with all the saints into your heavenly dwelling place. Encourage us with the promise that all who call upon your name we are saved. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of the world in need, for the sake of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all. We invite you to rise and share a sign of peace with those around you. God's peace.
She's still down in Connecticut. So the joint choir will pray for offering when I survey the wondrous cross arranged by Jason.
As we prepare for communion, if you didn't get the elements, they were in the baskets on the way in. Feel free to go out and get them. They have wine in the ones, and the other ones are labeled the GJ for grape juice. All are welcome at this table. If you're here and wanting Jesus' grace and mercy in your life, and you want to share communion, we're so glad you're here and being a part of this with us. Let us pray. Extravagant God, you have blessed us with the fullness of creation, and now we gather at your feast, where you offer us the food that satisfies. Take and use what we offer here, come among us, and feed us with the body and blood of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
If you haven't already, I invite you to open the elements at this time. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy One, the beginning and the end, the giver of life, blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, given and shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours. Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord has been revealed to us in the bread and the wine, his body and his blood. Let us pray. Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer the song of grateful hearts, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. At this time, it's time for some announcements. If you have an announcement, please come on forward. Use the microphone and turn on the camera. While people are getting up here, I will point out that we have the Lenten worship schedule. We are meeting on Wednesdays at 7 o'clock every Wednesday until we get to Holy Week. And on Sundays, we'll be at 9:30 as we have been during Holy Week. Palm Sunday is 9:30. Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter Vigil are all 7 o'clock. And Easter Sunday will be 9:30 a.m.
Just to give you an update on how the progress is going with the Asylum Seeker Project, Of course, the next thing we need to do is to prepare Messiah House. And what happened this week is the plumber came and began working on the pipes that will take the water and also drain for the new shower. Also, the church council will be discussing on Tuesday two different estimates from the Grace Electric Company. Some of the work should come from the budget of the church, and some of the work should come from the money that we have given for the Asylum Seeker Project. And the church council will determine which is which. It looks like about $1,000 each. And then we've also engaged someone who will be putting in the floor, the final floor in that shower room, and that will come later. So thank you for your continued prayers and support.
Good morning, everybody. I don't know about you, but I was really excited to walk in here and see all the chairs in here again, feeling like, oh, home. It really is good to see everybody sitting in their favorite seats too. Another sign of home is these pans that you see in the narthex on the table in front of Joanne's window. You may remember these from the Ash Street shelter of days gone by. Ashley Goldberg and I are coordinating it now and trying to sort of do a hybrid method of signing up at church and also signing up online. So there will be pans and lists here for people to sign up if you want. And Ashley will also be sending out emails to see who wants to volunteer. We'll synchronize it. And then a couple days before the Ash Street delivery, she will send out a reminder. So the Ash Street delivery is this Thursday. I'll be driving. I'll be picking up here at the church, and going forward, all the pickups will be here at the church. So 5:15, drop off what you have. So far, it's been great. The only thing we have a blank on is dessert. So if anyone would like to make dessert for Thursday, put your name on and we'll be ready to go. So thank you very much.
Good morning. So I'd like to thank everybody in the Times Choir for their beautiful music, all the hard work they've put together and putting together our songs. We'll be playing again this week for Holden on Wednesday. No rehearsal today after church, but anyone who is interested in singing with the choir for Easter, please stay for a little bit after church. If you have enough, we can run through some music. And if not, we can just talk briefly. So, thank you.
And I don't know if we said it this morning. If we did, I'm going to say it twice. A huge thank you to Trudy and Lynn for these new chime tables. They did an outstanding work. This kind of stuff just appears at the church from one week to another. It's just glorious. So, thank you.
Our next deadline for love funds applications is April 1st. And if you are a volunteer, along with two other volunteers from Messiah and a nonprofit, you can apply for this. And as long as it fits in with our mission, which is we serve in response to God's love for all by committing ourselves to all human needs, standing with the poor and powerless by advocating for dignity and justice for all. So on the bulletin board and also on the website, there are two applications. There's a general application, again, if you are connected with a nonprofit, or if you want to start a special ministry at Messiah, along with two other Messiah members, you can apply for this, okay? So it's April 1st. Okay, and my next announcement is referring to something that you have seen in the bulletin. We probably all have heard or watched signs of what's happening in this week in Ukraine. And, you know, our heart goes out in our compassion. And in this way, we can do something about it besides prayer and advocacy. ELCA's Lutheran Disaster Response is having a special appeal. And it accompanies other Lutheran churches in Ukraine, in Poland, in Hungary, and Slovakia. So money will be going to them so that they can help the people around there in those four countries. Also, Lutheran Disaster Response partners with Lutheran World Federation, LWF, and also Church World Service. And they also, in turn, share food, water, hygiene kits, blankets. So if you're interested in helping, please do that. I've communicated with Diane Benfiglio, and if we get checks into Messiah with the memo LDR-Ukraine, we get them by the end of March, she will get that right out. So we don't have to wait, you know, for many months. We can have aid to them. So thank you.
Thank you.
And then on the back of that insert, we can still do prayer and advocacy in addition to sending money. If you'd like to be a part of prayer, there's a prayer vigil today at Christ the King in Nashua at 4 o'clock. You're welcome to join Kim and Kai, and I will be there. And I think the Episcopalian Church in Nashua is also being a part of this. But if you'd like to come and be a part of that, you're most welcome. Roxanne, I need you to come up here, please. As you all know, we were at the annual meeting, you approved raises for the staff. We are grateful for that. You also gave us a bonus for COVID. This is just a little token from the staff. Thank you back to all of you. You bless us with your generosity and your support. Thank you. Thank you, Roxanne. Thank you. If you missed it, we have a Lent devotional that's out. It's on the website electronically, and it's hard copy out there. Take as many as you want. If we run out, we'll print more. These are for you and for whoever wants to use them to use. There's one for each of the 40 days of Lent. It was written by David and Ed and Linda and I. It's a joy for us to do this, and it's even more joyful if people read them. So thank you. I saw Claudette this week, or last week actually, and she wanted me to make sure to greet all of you. So Claudette says hi. She's still in her neck brace, but hopefully gonna get out of it soon. So if you got a little extra room in your prayers for that, that would be wonderful. She's very tired of being in a neck brace, but she certainly wanted to make sure that you all heard a hello from her. Council is this week at 7 o'clock on Tuesday. I presume we're in Zoom. Is that right, Roxanne? Zoom? Yes, Pam? Yes, we're saying yes. Maybe not in the future. Who knows? But this week we're in Zoom. And if you want to join us, you're welcome. We will certainly be talking about masks and eating together going forward, among other things. So if you want to be part of that conversation, this would be a good council meeting to join us. Let's see. We're still looking for some help for the anniversary celebrations. May 15th, Bishop Hazelwood will be here with us. If you'd like to help plan the party and the things going on around that, that would be wonderful. Please talk to me. We are in the home stretch for signing up for the trip to Germany. The Rhinuses and Brian are going. If other people want to go to Lutherland and Oberammergau, which got put off for 2 years because of the plague, which is ironic, and I can tell you why later. You want to sign up and get your payment in by March 15th. So you have like 9 days. The clock is ticking. Let's see. Two other things. Sorry, I got a lot today. We finished our Rachel Held Evans book, and the next book we're doing is Love Without Limits by Jacqueline Bussey. We're going to start that in a couple of weeks. We meet Thursday at 7:15. If you'd like to be a part of this, you want to track down this book. It's a good book, obviously, or we wouldn't be studying it, and we'd love to have you join our study. So if you have any questions, talk to me, but you want to track this down, and I can show this to you again if you need it. And lastly, you might have noticed up here, we have a new communion set. And we have a whole bunch of plaques up here as well. These are house blessing plaques. We intend to visit as many of the households of this congregation as will allow us, hopefully all of them. And the idea is that I would come and a council member or a member of the mutual ministry would come. We'd have a prayer with you. We'd have communion with that very set, which I took out for a test spin on Ash Wednesday. It works just fine. You'll get one of these plaques up here. If they look very primitive, I did those, I'm sorry. But there's some nice ones too. So if you sign up earlier, you're more likely to get a nice one. There's a little incentive. But there are signups on the table out in the narthex. And what I'm asking you to do is just put your name by those hours that could work for you. And then we'll have to coordinate with the other people coming. So like if all those work for you, write your name on all seven sheets. If only some of them work, or you really need a certain time, just sign those ones. And we'll try and get those all scheduled. The hope is to get these done during Lent, to spend time with you, prayer with you, and maybe even get a little material that we can use in our anniversary celebration. So please be open to this. We look forward to meeting with you. Are there any other announcements this morning? All right, please rise for a blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our sending hymn is on the outside page of the board.
Number 4.
Thanks be to God.